Hey everybody, Hidden Object Guru here, joined as frequently by...
The Night Dog. Hello!
Night Dog. Hey, we're here playing the demo for hot new game, Nioh.
It looks pretty darn cool.
Yeah, it does. You play a samurai. The big hook of this game is that it's based apparently on a script or a treatment that Akira Kurosawa wrote years and years ago, and they bought the rights to it, about a half-white, half-Japanese samurai meeting ghosts. I'm sure his wasn't about going to a ninja island and murdering hordes of ghosts, but it does at least have that pedigree.
But it has nothing to do, despite being named Nioh. It's spelled differently. So it has nothing to do with Keanu Reeves being a half-white samurai going to an island of ghost ninjas. Remember when that happened, when he did that? That was a thing. 49 Ronin, 47 Ronin, was
47
it?
47 Ronin, yeah. That was pretty wonderful, actually.
Yeah.
I have no idea how to play this game. It's a demo for a brand new game. Oh, a game that isn't even out yet?
Yeah.
And so I have no idea. It's apparently, everyone has described it as Dark Souls, but for samurai.
Mm-hmm.
So that's what I'll be playing it as. I'll be trying to play it like a Dark Souls game. But, an Uchi Katana is what I have now.
So you have, like, various, like, kami here, I guess, who give you, when you go to shrines, stuff you need. Is that...
I think the shrines are where you level up.
Okay, I see.
All right, so I'm going to equip a samurai sword.
Mm-hmm.
And now I'm going to try to use it. I don't know how to use it yet. On the right side of the screen, there's this little thing of a picture of a dude samuraiing. But, it's the various stances you can use. That's cool. But I don't know how to draw. By the way, here's a thing I should probably learn. How to draw a sword.
Yeah, that would be probably, in a samurai-based game, one of the first things you're going to want to know to do.
Yeah, totes. But, so we'll figure it out. Anyway, I have news I heard about the other day, and I wanted your thoughts on.
What's that?
It's media-related news, which I know, I mean, you're excited about the media in...
Yeah, all the time. Yeah.
There we go. I got my sword. Mm-hmm. I have three stances, and I'm ready to go. That's right. I feel like I have to do sound effects and go, even though obviously the game is doing sound effects of its own.
It is. Yeah. You gotta add to the experience.
So these are swords in the ground. Whoa! Oh, what the heck is wrong with this guy?
Are you making him run around like that?
I don't know if you've seen it yet, but this jerk just started attacking me.
Oh, yeah, sorry.
Like, and he's, I thought it was a game about fighting. Oh, my God!
I'm seeing what
8 seconds, you're going to see someone's head come off like he was a dandelion.
Yeah, for those in the peanut gallery, there is a delayed reaction of about 5 seconds or so.
Once we get you in the same room with me, it's going to be much easier to...
We'll overcome that issue.
Oh, totes. So hold left trigger and to dash. Okay, I like that you didn't tell me how to draw my sword before I was going to get into a fight.
You think that would be one of the very first things.
Yeah, so apparently this is the grave... Of another person who died playing the game.
Okay.
And I can summon them and then fight a version of them. I'm not fighting a real person here.
Okay.
I'm fighting, like, the computer could... Oh, wow, and they killed the H out of me. Freed from the mortal coil. Don't be a jerk about this. Ouch. And so, yeah, I'm fighting the ghost of a person
who died to
the bandit.
So do you mean to say that this is actually based on, like, you know, through the miracle of online gaming, like somebody else's actual character, or is it just like
it's somebody else's actual character?
Oh, that's crazy. Okay.
It is crazy. All right, so I'm going to try fighting the bandit again. And hopefully I'll do a little better this time. I'm doing a little better this time. I still don't know. Ooh, so square is light attack and triangle is heavy attack. And that is the valuable lesson I have learned. So should I try fighting another ghost, or should I just move forward?
See if you can beat this ghost, I guess.
All right, I'll try the ghost one more time.
And then, you did.
When I fail quite desperately, I will give up fighting ghosts.
Mm.
Which culture has the hungry ghosts?
That I think it's China? Tibet. Tibet. I want to say it's Tibet, but it could be China as well. It could be like a number of Eastern Buddhist cultures.
Okay. So Hungry Ghost might just be a...
I was literally talking about that last night, which is so
really?
Weird. Really? Yeah, why would I be...
Well, it's a classy name, Hungry yeah. Ghost.
Yeah.
You know, it's very evocative.
Yeah.
All right, so here's the point. I was actually going to talk about a thing, and now I'm going to bring it up. So, recently, as in the past week, they have announced that there is going to be do-to-do-to-do, that's my trying to get you excited sound effect, a Punisher TV show.
Okay, so like a Netflix series?
Yeah, yeah. And, I came really close to getting this guy. But, okay. And yikes. So, as I'm sure you've noticed, the Punisher was a fairly prominent and popular part of the Daredevil Season 2.
Yes, yes.
And I think I, like a lot of people, when I saw the episode where he was in jail and had to murder a bunch of guys in a jail cell, I'm like, give this man his own TV show.
Yeah, absolutely. That's why that episode existed, basically.
I don't think I was alone in having that reaction to that episode.
Yeah, not in the least.
And apparently, the people at Netflix felt the same way because now they are giving him his own TV show.
That's excellent. I assumed from the very get-go, having Punisher in Daredevil was basically just understood to be a stepping stone to there being a...
Daredevil TV show.
Yeah, a Punisher TV show. Huh.
All right, I'm taking one last shot at a ghost, and then I'm just giving up on this ghost fighting thing.
Yeah.
Because it's a cool idea, me fighting the ghost of people who got killed, but, you know, I'm terrible at it.
Yeah.
So that...
You'll learn.
I'm someone who is level one, so I'm hoping that will help. Because I kept fighting a guy who... Okay, maybe the guy I was already fighting was level one as well, and I was just bad at it, but...
Right.
I don't even know how to parry yet in the game. Like, I almost didn't beat that first enemy because... Oh, no! I suck at this. Yeah, maybe... Here's a spoiler alert, people out there. Maybe learn how to play the game before fighting angry ghosts.
Yeah.
That might be a technique.
I think it's not too much of a button mash kind of thing.
Oh,
here.
God, no. I think it's mostly about technique.
Oh,
and
yes.
I obviously have none.
Right.
Because, I don't even know how to parry in the game. Okay. Parrying is, of course, a huge part of Dark Souls. As I explained to you last time, you knock their swords away, and then you do finishing moves on them. And that's what just happened to me in the... the other game, that's what the angry ghost did to me, but
right.
I don't know how to do that to other people. This is the bloody grave of Nobu the Swordmaster, and I can fight the Revenant. He drowned here. And you'll notice he doesn't have a ludicrous name like Vargilon, so that's an actual NPC version rather than a person that's like one placed there by the game rather than someone who was playing it and died.
I see, yes, yes. Whereas if you were going up against somebody named,
Riftlock.
Riftlock.
Yeah. I said Riftlock, but yes, Riftlock works too.
Okay,
The point is, I'm bad at making up names.
Yeah, I was happy that you jumped in, because I couldn't think of anything. Okay. I was going to say Devil Dog 69 Yo.
Well, I'm sure yours is more accurate than...
I'm glad I didn't, and now I have, so I've, you know, failed or something, but...
Do I have any other? No, Mariner's pants, arm guards, Mariner's boots. Ooh, I have new. I have new boots, which give me my defense up from 1 to 9. Also, I get more gold. I mean, maybe this will turn out great. I generally hate loot based games.
Yeah.
I don't want to stop every 15 minutes and compare stats of equipment to decide what I should be wearing.
Yeah.
But I know that a lot of people do like loot in games, so I'm not going to pretend that I'm. Universal in this belief.
Sure.
So, the Punisher, he's got a TV show. Do you have thoughts on that?
I gotta say I'm excited. I enjoyed the Punisher in this season of Daredevil. Yeah. Not too many complaints. Was it Ray Winston? Was he the last Punisher?
Ray Stevenson.
Ray Stevens. I always
I mix them up all the time myself.
Yeah, Ray Winston's old. Well, I guess he's older. I think he's
a little older.
Yeah, yeah, and he's
I think the this is gonna sound bad. Beefier.
He's beefier. It's the most successful person from '80s Robin Hood.
I forgot he was in that. What he was? Yeah. Little John, right?
He was Will Scarlet.
Will Scarlet, yeah. Thank you.
The little John guy was in... He was the guy who got his hand bit off by a dire wolf in Game of Thrones. He was the one who was like, yeah, really? The true king of the north.
And he then was he got hand bitten off.
That's nice. Right, yeah.
Yeah, but, he was a fool to question Robb Stark's ability to be King of the North.
Yeah, he didn't know he was messing with a hard man, I guess. To use the colloquial.
The wonderful, wonderful cliched thing.
Yeah.
Offering.
But, it occurs to me, that, you know, we spent, I believe it was last episode, picking holes in and beating to death Walking Dead.
Yeah.
I understand, though I've never really seen Walking Dead, that the guy who played Punisher in Daredevil is from The Walking Dead. Is that right?
Yeah. That's where he is most famous for being from. He's been in a bunch of other stuff, but he's most famous for being ne'er-do-well Shane in seasons 1 and 2 of The Walking Dead.
Yeah. Now, even though Walking Dead is something that you have, delineated its awfulness.
Yeah. Oh God. I cut off both his arm and head this time.
Oh nice.
These guys are yikes. They are just coming apart like action figures.
Yeah.
All right. Yes, I was talking about how awful The Walking Dead is.
Yeah. Was his performance in Walking Dead all right though? Like,
he's good. I mean, he's a good actor.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't complain about his acting at all.
Yeah. So it's like, as I was saying, Ray Stevens, his Punisher movie, excellent movie. Anybody who...
Oh, I loved, I think, and I don't think we're the only ones who loved a little movie called Punisher Warzone.
Yeah, and it received, like, the least, I'm not going to say acclaim, the least promotion, let's say, of all the Punisher movies that they made, right? You got your Lundgren Punisher, your, help me out,
Tom Jane,
yeah. I wanted to say J. Michael Stevens. I don't even know who that is.
Not even a name.
I don't think that's a person. Anyway.
It's technically a name, but it's not really a, it's not someone famous.
I'm obviously just combining Ray Stevens with J. Michael
Stevens
or something, and then, it's all a mess in my head. But anyway, you had those two, and those are, well-known, but they don't really, for me... get the Punisher, right? Yeah. Whereas the Ray Stevens one, he's still a Vietnam vet, like, which you can't do now. So, like, I understand.
No, he can't be a Vietnam vet anymore.
Yeah, like, even though I feel that's, like, so integral to what the Punisher was when he was, like, at his height of popularity, like, the whole, like, late 80s, early 90s, Mike Baron.
Well, I mean, there is the key element to what the Punisher is, and I was reading an article about, oddly, Death Wish.
Yeah.
They really touched on it, which is the Punisher came about because, A... Mm-hmm. horrible traumatic war in Vietnam.
Yeah.
And then B, like, the perceived complete breakdown of social order in New York.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So you had this idea that it's like a guy would come home from Vietnam and it was hell, and crime in New York was so bad that his family got killed, and now he's going to use his skills to clean up New York. Mm-hmm. You may recognize this plot from 1,000 movies in the 80s.
Exactly. Yeah, in the 80s. Everybody, even like more peacenik characters like MacGyver, fought in Nam, like were in some way involved. It was like just accepted that every single hero had this backstory where it's like he was in Nam and he either had an illegitimate child or he has to.
Oh my God! Everybody had an illegitimate Vietnamese child.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, it was a whole thing, right? And it was like,
dude,
was just...
that showed up on Gem.
You're kidding me. Someone had
one of the orphans at Starlight House is an illegitimate Vietnamese war orphan who wants to find her father, redheaded American.
That's an amazing it was
amazing is the point.
Yeah, is that integral to the
national I'm not trying to gloat here or impress people, but America's national myth.
Yes, exactly, yes.
It was that it was that big of a part of the story of America for a really long time.
Like everybody, like, Riggs, and Murtaugh, I think were both in Nam.
Oh, they were both Nam vets. It's
what?
Riggs was Special Forces.
That's right. I don't think that that John McClane was ever said to have been in
Nam. No, he was not in Vietnam.
No, yeah. But, so it was a very common thing, and it always was, like, integral to the Punisher, and yet in the 1980s Punisher movie, it was still 89 when they made the Dolph Lundgren film, he was just a cop, right? And to me, it's like, it always makes more sense that he's meant to be a Special Forces guy, which they still have in and Daredevil.
Yes.
Right? So I was glad that was there. Whereas in the Tom Jane one and the Dolph Lundgren one, he's a cop. And I think that misses the point because it's meant to be like, this is a kind of a force on the streets that is going to seem like alien to just police officers. It's a guy with like military training or whatever, right? And
yes.
And yeah, you kind of need that. And so they have that here. The only thing that I like, you know, minorly, and this is just like minor nitpicking, it isn't like, you know, ooh, it sucked because of this, that I didn't like is that he had the jarhead haircut.
Yeah.
And I know that they thought, oh, well, we're being true to what a Marine is, a Marine, right?
Or yeah, he's a Marine.
Yeah, he's a Marine. What a Marine looks like, right?
Well, yeah, while yeah. he's a Marine.
Yeah, while he's a Marine, but it's like, if you're going around trying to, like, be, like, you know, secretly operating on the streets as this vigilante, you're not really going to want to call attention to that, so that's why it makes sense that the Punisher doesn't have a Marine haircut, but... No,
he really should not have the jarhead haircut, you're right.
Yeah, because he would often, in the comics and such, he would often, and I think he even does that in you know, here, he would go incognito and he would use some kind of name, like...
That would be Frank Rook.
Yeah, exactly. Frank Rook. Yes, exactly. Frank Rook.
Which, by the way, I'm not saying that, you know, the television is really, really generic and reusing thing, but in the show Castle, which I kind of enjoy, his last name's Castle, and the fake name he has for a character based on him is Rook. And I'm like, were you guys Punisher fans?
Obviously.
I feel like you guys were Punisher fans.
Yeah.
But anyway.
Yeah, so...
Yeah, it's very interesting.
Yeah, so
but
the
you
idea
can't really go undercover when you look like that.
No, no, and the idea of doing a show based on the Punisher, I can only assume it's going to be great fun. Like,
it has to be, right?
Yeah, I don't want to, you know, jinx things by you know building it up and then ending up disappointed. But I mean, like, I was not really disappointed with Punisher in Daredevil.
No,
you know?
His elements of Daredevil were not terrible.
No.
The
no.
contrived coincidence that his old CO was now running a, you know, a heroin ring out of New York and had been responsible for his family's death.
Yes.
I mean, they've done stuff in, they did stuff in The Punisher about guys he knew in Nam becoming drug kingpins.
Yeah, yeah,
because
for sure.
That's a thing that you know, I mean, I'm not saying that specific thing really happened, but stuff like that happened.
Yeah, yeah, there was a lot of, like, drug trafficking, like, you know, like the Frank Lucas thing and the Air America and all that or whatever. Yeah, so that's, you know, all legit stuff or whatever.
The Frank Lucas story is incredibly interesting.
Yeah.
And they made 100 movies about that guy.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
Which, by the way, how on earth do you make the Frank Lucas story starring Denzel Washington and not have a scene where Frank Lucas goes to see Black Caesar?
yeah, because that
how
really
how do you
happens.
Leave that out?
Yeah, like the actual Frank Lucas did go
he
and
about like he knew Fred the Hammer Williamson. He met him,
you know,
afterwards. So how do you leave that out of the movie? That's so fascinating.
That would
it's
be
like,
cool.
Here's this guy who has become a cultural figure like that in his own life.
Yeah.
It's fascinating, but they completely leave that out of the movie, which made me a little sad. Mm-hmm. Oh, I am dying a lot, aren't I?
Run.
Yeah, I just cannot get away from these guys. Although, it doesn't help that I am getting, like, that the game has not deigned to teach me any defensive techniques whatsoever.
I gotta say, good or bad, what I can say about this game so far is it seems pretty merciless.
Oh, yeah, it's terrible. Although, I mean, in the game's defense, I'm just walking around in a shirt.
That
so
is,
all of these guys have armor on, and I have a shirt.
I'm just saying, if you like a challenge so far, it seems like this might be, you know, up your alley.
Oh, yeah. But I read one, like, little note of this demo, which is maybe just spam kill the first guy over and over again until he drops some equipment so you don't die all the time.
Yeah, that might be preferable.
I was trying to do something that was more visually interesting for our viewers, but maybe I should just be cheesing this game pretty hard. Anyway, so yeah, like the Frank Lucas stuff, things like that. Like, there's plenty of like real life antecedents for the blacksmith story on Punisher. Yeah,
but with this, and I guess we should have said spoiler alert to begin with, but we'll
no, we're not spoiler alerting. We're assuming people have seen Daredevil.
Yeah.
Also, Clancy Brown being the villain is neither a surprise nor super relevant to the plot.
Yeah, I saw someone else say this in an online review that it's like, you know, and this was someone, you know, praising it and just loving it pretty heavily. Oddly, if more for the Daredevil angle than the Punisher angle, strangely,
the Daredevil stuff was super weak this year.
Yeah, I know, that's what I thought was strange about this
review. The Punisher stuff was the good stuff. But anyway, sorry.
But other than that, though, like, they said, oh, really? Yeah, because it was really... really compelling how the guy who has played an evil military commander in literally everything in the last, like, you know, 10 years would be, you know, turn out to be yet again an evil military commander.
Yeah, no. Yeah. That's all Clancy Brown does.
Well, I mean, that's what he was in, like, was it Arrow recently or Daredevil? Or
Flash and Arrow, I think.
Flash and Arrow, yeah. Crazy evil military commander, yeah. But, yeah, so that wasn't really a surprise. But it's like, yeah, in the comic, it was just the Mafia.
Yeah.
Did that, and it made more sense because in this, we're expected to believe that Clancy Brown had orchestrated this, like, mass meeting of, like, several different major families, New York gangs, right?
Which he was going to be supplying with drugs.
Yeah, and it was held in Central Park, where like a family.
Just Central Park, like the Ferris wheel at Central Park.
A Ferris wheel, yeah, like a heavily trafficked area. Whereas I think the actual thing with the Punisher, he was either in a park or on a beach, like flying a kite with his family or something.
No, he was having a picnic with his family.
Yeah,
and then, and this is the key part. What happened was like a mob guy was just out in the park. Mm-hmm. He thought to meet somebody casually, and a different group of mob guys were like, we're setting him up to be assassinated here.
Yeah.
And then so that mob guy got surprised, and then a gunfight started.
Yeah, and his family just happened.
And his family happened to be there and got killed. And that's the story of the Punisher. Whereas this, like, they decided to have a giant meeting of 150 mobsters at the Central Park Ferris wheel, where there are guaranteed to be children.
Yes.
All of whom brought guns. And by the way, somehow they managed to cover this up.
Yeah, they managed to cover it up. And then it turned out that the cover-up didn't have anything to do with the DA who was covering it up being corrupt, per se. Just the DA wanted to cover up the fact that
an undercover cop had helped set up the thing that got all these people killed.
Yeah. And it's like, and then it just so happened by, you know, one in a million coincidence that the guy who had orchestrated it all was his former CO. Yeah, right?
And I mean, it had nothing to do with the fact that he was there.
No, he wasn't trying to, like, make him pay for the fact that, what was it, that the CO had made, like, a mistake in the field and it got his arm blown off and then Frank had saved the day, right? But it wasn't like he was out for revenge on Frank or anything.
Nothing
it was just
to do
a bizarre coincidence, right? And it's like, that was a little bit weak, but it's like, that doesn't have anything to do with, like, you know, that's not going to sour future Punisher TV show. It was just, you know, a little bit weak. They should have probably just stuck it. I think I prefer it. Maybe I'm too much of, like, a Steve Ditko type or whatever, right? Or, like, Steve Ditko, like, when, you know, they were like, who's it going to turn out that the Green Goblin is? And, like, Stan Lee's like, let's make it the dad of Peter's best friend. And Ditko's like, no, it should be nobody we've ever heard of. He's just a nobody.
He's just some guy. What does it matter?
His obsession with the idea that, like, you know, some figure under the mask, he could be any nobody. That's not what matters, really, or whatever, right? Like, that whole thing, right? But it's like, yeah, I don't.
Although Steve Ditko, to be famous, was a crazy person.
Yes, he was and is, because he's still alive.
He remains a legit crazy person.
Yeah, and I would totally recommend that everybody watch that British Ditko documentary. I think it's In Search of Steve Ditko.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Yeah, it's great. But
you learn a lot about how comics happen and why comics used to be crazy.
Yeah, because they used to have fantastic, entertaining nuts writing everything.
Just a madman creating.
Yeah. Now they only have, like, a small handful of amazing, crazy geniuses like Alan Moore and stuff, but, you know, still.
I was reading just 70s Batman, and I came across a Ditko creation of the 70s, and I don't remember his name. It's like, The Freak!
wasn't the Creeper?
No, not Creeper. It's post that. It's like, he's this weirdo, and he's got, you know, crazy sunglasses and a multicolored psychedelic suit.
So he's almost the Creeper.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. He's just like, the whole point is, he's just a weirdo that's going to confuse people who look at him and, you know, offend the squares. And that's all he wants to do. And it's like, literally, he's just a surrealist superhero. It was very strange.
And almost
I don't
sounds like
think he became popular.
That's like, that almost is like what Mysterio could have been had he been invented like 10 years later or something.
Yeah. He really could have. The psychedelic supervillain.
Yeah, I always felt that
anyway should have been.
If they had made a Spider-Man movie like 10... Well, they did make Spider-Man movies 10 years ago.
They did,
I'm saying if they had. At that time, I remember thinking, if they do one with Mysterio, is he just going to be Chris Angel Mind Freak? Because Mysterio, he's an illusionist, but he's also a stuntman.
Yeah.
And like a Hollywood, you know, special effects guy. Like, kind of, he's meant to be some kind of blend between these things. And that's sort of what Chris Angel Mind Freak was kind of presented as anyway, right? And it's like, So there's a thought for today. But
So here's my question to you.
Yeah.
Cast from bronze, it evokes a temple bell. Oh, my hammer is themed after a temple bell.
Nice. Oh, cool.
All right, so what do you think? First off, are you looking forward really to a Punisher TV show?
Of course,
I think the answer is probably yes.
Mm-hmm.
But what are you hoping to get out of a Punisher TV show? Because I think you and I are about equally familiar with Punisher knowledge, because I collected every Punisher comic ever, and then I lent them to you.
That's right.
And, you read them all.
That's right, and I appreciate that. And
best.
It was a life-changing experience. I really loved it, because when Punisher first came out, I wasn't reading the Punisher comics at that time, right? I was just like, I don't know, reading Spider-Man or something, right? And I would see Punisher when he would appear in Spider-Man and so forth,
which
right?
He did once in a while.
Oh,
he was originally created as a Spider-Man, not villain?
Yeah, he was hired by the Jackal.
And it's this weird situation where he thought he was a good guy.
Yeah.
And people, and correct me if I'm wrong about any of this, like, people, like, the Jackal was trying to frame Spider-Man and make people think he was evil or something like that?
Yeah, something along those lines. I don't remember the exact nature of the story, just that the Jackal hired the Punisher and convinced him that Spider-Man was some kind of criminal, and therefore, you know, he sent him after him, basically. And he was, you know, and that was the first appearance of the Punisher, and it was, you know, basically just ripping off, Mac Bolan's executioner, right? They're like, what if that character showed up Stan Lee often tries to take credit that he created the name the Punisher. I think it's just one of the many, like, apocryphal stories he tells.
Yeah.
It's like, you know, we had this robot up here that Galactus had, and he was called the Punisher, and I'm like, why don't we reuse that name? I don't think that that is necessarily true, but that's just my own personal thoughts.
Well, considering that there were characters like the Punisher and the Executioner and the Destroyer existing in men's adventure fiction,
exactly,
it would be weird for him to be able to take credit for that.
Exactly. So I think what I'm hoping for, and I'm guessing you might feel the same way, is that what you loaned me was the first several years, you know, the very popular and formative Mike Baron run of the Punisher, who basically kind of like really fleshed out and kind of, you know, did Mike Baron do the miniseries that
no, he did not do Circle of Blood.
Okay, he didn't do Circle.
That was somebody else whose name is blanking me at the moment. But that's the definitive.
Yeah.
Circle of Blood is the creation of the modern Punisher.
Yeah, where it tells his backstory and all that in a more detailed way. That was by the
mid-80s. What's interesting most about Circle of Blood is it literally starts with him in prison.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
Like, he's been jailed for being the Punisher.
Yeah.
So it starts, he's been thrown into prison, and he's like, okay, I gotta get out of prison. I'm gonna get involved in mob politics inside jail. And then, you know, figure my way out. And
how much of this bears a resemblance of Circle of Blood bears a resemblance to what happened in this Daredevil series when he's in jail?
Not much.
Yeah.
No, there's no Daredevil in jail, and the people who break him out are guys who claim to be wanting to get rid of the mob.
Yeah.
And they're like, we're going to break you out. And weirdly, I guess that is really similar, because that is the stated values of Wilson Fisk in the TV shows. He's like, I need you out there punishing mob guys so I can come in and deal with them when I get out.
Yeah.
And what's interesting is in the comic book, that is what's going on. But they try to hide the fact that they just want to take over the underworld. And they claim that they're concerned citizens who want to get rid of the mob entirely.
Right.
You know, concerned rich guys who are like, we'll give you the funding, Punisher, and you'll become a member of the Trust, and we're going to use you to kill all the mobsters. But then, of course, it turns out that what they're trying to do is, and it gets a little convoluted, because they're both just trying to get rid of the mob to, you know, so they can make room for their own criminal enterprises.
Yeah.
But also, this is the puzzling part, they are busy trying to get brain, like, track how the Punisher operates.
Okay.
So they can brainwash people
and
turn them into an army of Punishers to do this job for them. And that's where it gets a little away from,
it's,
you know, the logic of the world of the Punisher.
Yeah, because I think it was kind of appealing about the Punisher, right? Especially the Mike Baron run, is though it was set in the mainstream Marvel universe, the so-called Earth 616 or whatever, right?
Yeah.
It at the same time is mostly set in kind of like a, you know, it just sort of like sidesteps the fact that it takes place in a world with mutants and things like that. It's like in the Punisher's adventures mostly circulate around like kind of real lifey stuff, right?
Exactly.
And so basically what was great about the Mike Baron things is they were very episodic. Like, maybe you might have, like, you know, something run the course of, like, 2 or 3 issues sometimes. But yeah, it was
like
basically...
when he worked with the Mossad to deal with some Muslim terrorists.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, like, that kind of thing. So it's like, you know, the Punisher would be like, this one, the Punisher goes against, you know, white supremacists. This one, the Punisher goes against, corrupt guys in the military. Like, this one, he goes against, you know, Jim Jones, you know, like, this kind of thing.
The Jim Jones ones were pretty good.
Yeah, so they would just pick something from the relatively recent headlines of, like, the, you know, either immediate or last 10 years kind of thing, you know, at the time, or last 15 years.
Dear
or so.
Audience, I know what you're thinking. Did the Punisher ever take on the savings and loan industry? The answer might surprise you. Yes, he did. Oh, no, wait. Based on my setup, there's no way you would be surprised by that fact? Oh, no. Okay, sorry. I guess I don't understand how sentence structure works.
Yeah, exactly. So it's like the Punisher, he would go up against, you know, some kind of, like, thing that, you know, was, as anyone who's seen movies from then or lived through the time or whatever knows, that in the 80s, and it's funny because I often wonder, like, how much of this you can just attribute to Frank Miller alone, but let's assume that it was a sort of a general zeitgeist or whatever, right? Which, by the way, would be a great name for some kind
general
of
zeitgeist, yeah.
An evil, you know, World War II Nazi super soldier bad guy, General Zeitgeist. Anyway, so...
It controls the way people think of the war.
Yes, exactly. You
know, he gets into your thoughts.
He is the ultimate propagandist.
Yeah.
Orwell created him through genetic engineering or whatever, yeah.
So. I'm super happy with that, so please continue.
Yeah. But, anyway, what was I saying about the gen? Oh yeah, of that time, yeah, with all the fiction, right? It would always have this thing like in RoboCop, in Stallone's Cobra, the idea that it's like crime is off the charts and you know, everywhere, and like the movie would always a movie you would have like RoboCop, for instance, like would open up and it's telling you like Detroit of the not too distant future is like this criminal hellhole where criminals have the run of things, and then we're showing for the first like you know act of the film. Criminals,
they're running rampant. They running can do rampant. Whatever they want.
Yeah, they're so extreme. They're stapling, you know, a dead cat to the front of a nunnery or whatever the hell they said in Miller's Dark Knight. You know, that kind of thing. Gangs. And that you're just made to hate them so much. Like, you're meant to be like, you feel this emotional anger towards, you know, the crime that's going on, right? And then they have, like, the hero of the piece step in, you know, RoboCop or you know,
I'm the one guy who won't sit down and take it.
Yeah,
and again, it's all the Death Wish kind of mythology.
Exactly, that it's always like the legal system and the police are powerless to do anything, and there's just criminal scum running rampant. And then this guy steps in, and he just cleans the place up. He kills them all after they've made you hate them. He wipes them out, and you don't feel bad about it. You're really happy about it. You're like, yeah, take that, you know, and it. You know, it's often nuts, but it's the kind of stuff that you feel, even if it's nuts, it's like, it feels like it was in the headlines of the time, like even crazy things like, you know, Cobra, where it was like a survivalist cult.
Yes.
A secret survivalist cult that clack axes together and go around killing people for basically no reason, and they want society to collapse.
No, they
and it's
want
like...
to become survival of the fittest, and they hope that, you know, in a new modern future world where survival of the fittest has happened... They are the fittest, and they will rule this new world of, I don't know, just constant fighting with axes.
Yes.
I don't know what they imagine the world of the future will look like. I'd imagine it won't have, like, restaurants and places to go and buy food.
No, it'll mostly be some kind of Mad Max freak show. But it's like this, that kind of stuff is you know, very much, you know, the genre, right? And what was my point about that? Anyway, so yeah, so Punisher was very much like of that kind of milieu. It's like, you know, there's crime is everywhere.
Yeah.
And here's the guy who's going to clean up the crime. It wasn't about, you know, Electro trying to steal the city's, you know, power grids, electricity or whatever. You know,
yeah, he's going to become the middleman, and he can shut down the power grid if they don't pay him blackmail.
Yeah, he's
going to use it to become super powerful sometimes. I mean, it's Electro had nebulous goals.
He did. It's that kind of thing. It's not that kind of thing. I mean, to say it was mostly about like kind of, you know, real life crime taken to kind of like a maybe a ridiculous level, but
I'd say often a ridiculous extreme.
Yeah, and that's what I'm hoping that this series is going to be anyway, is I'm hoping it's just going to be mostly episodic and like can have like an overarching plot, but I'm hoping it's going to be like kind of like how X-Files was, it had the overarching alien plot, but it's like a lot of it was episodic with like stuff that didn't pertain to that. I'm hoping that the Netflix Punisher will have a lot of episodic adventures. And I know these Netflix things like Daredevil have been very serialized. Like,
someone's criticism of the new season of Daredevil was there's like three episodes worth of plot stretched out.
Yeah, that's true.
I wouldn't call it that bad, but, you know, it was very padded. And then you have Jessica Jones, which was nothing but padding.
Yes, yeah. I feel that Daredevil this season, it's like they probably initially weren't going to do the Punisher thing. Like, they probably had this whole Elektra plot that they were going to do. And then I figure they think, well, we'll make that two seasons. And a lot of that will be taking backseat to the Punisher stuff, because a lot of that was very disconnected, right? Like, what was going on with Punisher and what was going on with Elektra is almost, like, unusually disconnected,
right? And completely different shows, basically.
Yeah, yeah, and that's very much what it felt like. And I think it's because there had been such an outcry. I think you had told me that there was a kind of, like, a fan outcry. Like, why are you doing Jessica Jones? People want to see the Punisher, you know, Jessica Jones.
Yeah, people would rather see the Punisher than Jessica Jones.
Yeah, and, you know, Jessica Jones, I know we have kind of mixed feelings about that, too.
We do. I think it's the worst thing since sliced bread. Other people are kinder.
I'm a bit kinder to Jessica Jones. There were things in Jessica Jones I liked. I liked it was backdoor for Luke Cage.
I have not complained for one second about the presence of Luke Cage on television. And I unless, of course, the show is terrible and doesn't give Luke Cage the respect he deserves.
Yes, which
but the thing is, if there's no Luke Cage on television, how is the Punisher gonna become a black-skinned guy who teams up with Luke Cage?
Oh, that's true. That did happen.
It did happen once.
And it may happen still.
It almost certainly will not happen still.
you never know.
If someone were to ask me to guarantee the storyline that will not happen on the Punisher TV show, it's where he goes undercover by getting runs away by getting the black like me pigmentation augmentation surgery. You know, and becomes a black guy and then teams up with Luke Cage to fight some gangbangs.
What if he's played by a different actor and they explain that it was done with body switch technology?
I just think they're not going to do the story.
They probably are not. You're right.
And now we're going to do a video, a web video. It's like, you know, the one story that they won't dare to do on the Punisher TV show. And now we're doing that. All right, awesome. The one story they won't dare to do on the Punisher TV show. Make it like it's the story that's too hot for television.
As opposed to too silly and questionable.
Well, that is really what we're talking about, but it's funnier with my way.
Yeah.
So apparently I can become a living weapon by hitting triangle and circle at the same time when my adorable puppy there is all lit up. Oh, so let's find a guy to kill, and I'll try that out.
That sounds like a plan.
Is that a guy with a bow and arrow? It is. Ooh. Living weapon!
Yeah.
Oh my god. In a second, you're going to see that I have now friends with a fire puppy.
Oh, cool. Okay, so
I'll be like, did you just say a fire puppy? And I'll be like, yeah, a fire puppy. I'm trying to find somebody to kill before my fire puppy runs out.
Oh, now I see the fire puppy. That has happened now on my end here.
Yeah. So, thoughts on fire puppy?
Yeah, the fire puppy is pretty cool, and getting a axe made of flame, you know, can't complain there.
No. Who would be willing to complain about that?
Wow, that makes things way easier.
Yeah, I have been really struggling my way through this game until this point, and then it's like, you know, you can just have a fire puppy, right? And I'm like, no, I did not know that I could just have a fire puppy. Why was I not told about this ages ago?
Here's the thing I'm going to say right now. Maybe I'm just being too, you know, I'm too high on the fire puppy vibe right now. But I don't think Punisher ever had a wolf dog helping him in his adventures. But now I'm going to suggest that he should. Like on the show, he should have a dog.
Did the Punisher ever have a dog?
I have no recollection of the Punisher having a
dog. Because on the show, he had a dog. And then they, like, killed the Punisher's dog. And he was like,
well, he did, didn't he? He did have a dog.
Shouldn't have killed my dog.
Maybe I'll get a new dog.
How do I use the arrow? Did I miss
screen?
You forgot that he had a dog?
I can't believe I forgot that. I don't have a very good brain. So I'm hoping it'll be kind of like episodic stuff with an overarching plot as well. You know, like that's what I like. You know, there'll be some sort of. But now the thing is, they've already kind of blown the chances of doing a vengeance quest thing because he's killed the guy who orchestrated the death of his family, right? So in a certain sense, it's like, they've removed that as like the
But that never was a motivating factor in punishment.
No, it wasn't. And that's what I was saying earlier about the Ditko thing is like I like it when like what I didn't like about let's say the first Batman movie, the not the first Batman movie, but the Michael Keaton Batman movie, right?
Yeah.
Is that they felt the need to make the Joker the same guy who shot his parents.
Yeah,
right?
that was a pretty famous misstep.
Yeah, and it's like no, because the idea here is not that it's not about the particular, it's about like, you know, the universal, right? So it's like, you know, there was this bad thing that happened to him, bad particular thing that happened to him, but the universal principle of, you know, justice and saving the weak and all that kind of stuff is what he learned from this, and now he's going and, you know, saving other people and that
it's
kind of thing.
It's valuable whether or not he's exacting personal revenge.
Exactly, yeah. And it's like, if you make it into this, because Hollywood is kind of a little, or was, or is, or whatever, on the kind of individual vengeance quest, where, you know, because it's just one movie. It's not meant to be serialized, right? So it's like, they like the story to have that kind of, like, satisfactory sort of cyclical thing, where it's like, oh, he tracked down the guy who originally wronged him, and yada yada, right?
Right.
Okay. Now they're feeling the need to like push that into everything, right? Like, because Batman was so popular.
Hey, Tony Stark, I'm the one who, you know, betray. Although I gotta say, I guess was Jeff Bridges responsible for killing Tony Stark's dad?
I guess he
wasn't. But okay. Hydra was. Now. Yeah, they added that.
Or in the Flash TV series, for instance, Reverse Flash or Yobard Thong or whatever his name is, he traveled back in time.
Yobard Thong, the Reverse Flash.
Yeah, killed. Like when they added that to the story of the Flash, I know that's not just in the TV show. It was like
no, they've added that to the comic.
But too. It's a recent addition to the comic.
Fairly recent, yes.
You know, the last 10 years or something, right? And it's like as opposed to just being a guy who got powers and he's like, well, now I'll fight.
Just met an adorable little monster.
Yeah.
Who needs my help finding a shrine that he can become the shrine Kodama of.
Oh, that's... I see him now.
This game just got super cute.
This is amazing.
which longbow? This longbow. How do I use longbows?
Oh, cool. You got a longbow.
I got a longbow.
Yeah.
Is it going to tell me how to use this? It's not. Cool. Good. Thanks, guys. But anyway, you were saying... Sorry for interrupting you there.
Yeah.
You don't want it to be... Like, you don't want it to be too focused on him, like, continuing to... Well, I think that factors in with my thoughts on the subject, which is... And if I'm being too harsh here, please tell me.
Sure.
Because I have a history of being too harsh all the time about everything. I would like it if the Punisher, once his show starts, doesn't whine about his dead family anymore.
Yeah, not so much, right? I mean, he's avenged them now, right?
Yeah, like, he's avenged them, and the thing is, and this is what the show was missing, and this is what I feel a Punisher show needs.
Yeah.
But, and starting with Garth Ennis, and then everyone after Garth Ennis, Punisher stories these days tend to have a very judgmental tone to them.
Yes.
They seem to be operating under the basis that there's something wrong with being the Punisher.
Yeah, and I think we discussed this back when we talked about Batman, why he should kill, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, so if people want to revisit that episode, the idea that, like, within the world of comics, and still have this influence from the 50s comics code, there's this apologizing, or not even, you know, the idea that if you go and kill criminals, you must be psychologically insane, or whatever, right? Like, even though we're totally okay with cops killing criminals.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, like...
sorry about that.
It's, and so, like, you're saying that you feel there's, like, a judgmental tone in a lot of the contemporary stories in of that kind.
Yeah. I do think there is a judgmental tone in I can get blessings from Amaritas.
Oh, neat. And, you know, that mostly used to be confined to, like, when they would have him appear in other comics, like Spider-Man. Like he guessed in another comic, and they'd be like, you, Punisher... Or probably a wacko, because like the other characters don't kill him. I guess you have that in Daredevil.
You do. You have Daredevil constantly saying that Punisher's insane.
Yeah, and I'm like, I don't understand why the fact that he kills people is insane.
Well, I think the argument I made, and you tell me if this is convincing or not.
Uh-huh.
The argument I made was, this is a world where a group of Irish mobsters.
Yes.
Feel 100% comfortable walking into a store in the middle of the afternoon and blowing apart everybody who works there with shotguns.
Yeah.
Completely convinced that there will be no blowback of any kind from them having done that.
Yes, yes, which they seem to know from experience.
Yeah. So my question becomes, like, in a world that violent and brutal where the cops do nothing?
Yeah.
Don't we need a Punisher?
Obviously, answer is yes.
Like, am I the crazy one here?
Like, I mean, I think they did show in the series, like, a kind of snippets of different people's response to the fact that there was a Punisher, and there were people who thought he was good. Yeah. But yeah, we didn't see, like, a lot of that. And there's always this kind of thing, even if you go back to Death Wish, the original Death Wish.
Yeah.
There's this whole idea that, like, oh, the police would be so adverse to some guy going around killing criminal scum, right?
Yeah.
Yeah, and it's like, especially since this is not, like, some kind of spoiled, non-idealized real-life version of, like, some fat slob shot a 13-year-old boy who was flying a kite or something, right? It's not something like
that. He flew a kite onto his property, so he shot him a bunch.
Yeah, it's not something like that where there's going to be a public outcry.
Yeah.
It's always like the Punisher, 99 times out of 10, is killing unreasonably, ludicrously evil people that everyone is going to agree is evil.
Monstrously evil.
Yeah, just like monstrously evil mobsters who are tyrannizing, you know, everyone.
Thank you for saying tyrannizing.
Yes. Tyrannizing.
You have earned my respect, kind sir, with your love of the word tyrannizing.
So, yeah, that...
No, and that's, I think, a troubling aspect of the way people react to the Punisher. And it's
it
obviously infects the show because you have this ridiculous hypocrisy. And, I mean, on the Daredevil show, I honestly can't tell because so much of it was so shoddily done.
Yeah,
I honestly can't tell you whether they want us to think Matt Murdock is a hypocrite.
Yeah.
Or if the writers don't understand what they're saying. Because they have a show where Matt Murdock, you know, doesn't want to kill people. Like, is desperate for the Punisher not to kill people. And Colin says the Punisher could only kill people if he's insane. And I'll never kill anybody and blah, 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 blah. But at the same time, Matt Murdock only survives because people who are willing to kill keep saving his ass at the last minute.
Yeah, exactly. Elektra and Stick and Punisher all save
him. There is legit a part of that show where foot soldier, but of course that's a Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles.
Yeah.
A hand soldier follows him home, finds out that he's Matt Murdock, and Daredevil's response to that is, here's what I'm gonna do, hand soldier. I'm gonna let you go off and tell all the other hand people who I really am and who my friends are, so you can come back and kill all of us in our sleep.
Essentially, yes. Yeah.
That's his plan.
Yeah.
And it's up to Elektra to come in and just kill that guy so all of Matt Murdock's friends don't get killed.
Yeah.
But we want to say there, but the show gets super judgmental of Elektra because she did that.
Exactly, yeah.
And I worry that that kind of feeling is going to somehow make it into a Punisher TV show, which is the last thing that should be in a Punisher TV show.
Exactly, like, yeah. You want it to be just what it is. Like, I mean, the Punisher, that's what was good about Mike Barron's Punisher. He didn't apologize for
the fact that
Punisher was just, here's the Punisher, he shows up, he's going to fight criminals, and his understudy is going to shoot them. And it's like, I mean, I don't want to go into a side issue about talking about, like, Arrow and how ridiculous that is, because we could probably mine that for, like, a whole episode.
We'll do another episode about Arrow later. I'll watch all of this season, and once I've watched all of this season, we'll do an episode about Arrow. But for right now, let's stay laser focused on the Punisher if we
and because you look at the this season, right, and it's like of Daredevil.
Yeah.
And it's like the only person who is, you know, by the side of the Punisher and thinks the Punisher is, you know, doing the right thing is Karen Page, right?
Yeah.
But you can tell that within the story, the reason that is because last season Karen Page
murdered
shot the Ranger. Yeah, Wesley, that's right.
Wesley, the Ranger.
That's right.
Which, thank you for using his supervillain name.
They never called him that.
No one did last year.
No, it was like it wasn't even really understood that he was meant to be the Ranger.
Oh, he clearly was.
They totally, by the way, don't want to digress too much, but I don't feel they should have killed the Ranger and Banneric that early in the series, but
oh no, they thought there was only going to be one season.
Yeah, that's clearly what happened.
Like,
right?
When they were making the show, they thought we do one season of this, we do one season of that, and then we just do the Defenders. We do one season for each of these people, then we do the Defenders. Yeah, they had no idea that Daredevil was going to become a phenomenon, and they would have to do a second season.
Yeah.
So and that's why they killed the Arranger and Ben Urich.
Yeah, which because now you have the newsman filling in as Ben Urich. I'm like, did that newsman get arrested for corruption?
No, no. There's kind of a ludicrous scene at the end of the last season where it turns out he wasn't the corrupt one. It was another lady working there.
Yeah, yeah. That's
but at the same time, it's kind of strange. I don't understand on what basis the FBI is arresting her because all she did was give info to the Fisk organization about what the newspaper was reporting on.
Yeah, which isn't really a crime.
I don't think that's a crime.
No.
Well, she was getting paid with drug money. I guarantee she wasn't, though. I guarantee she was getting paid with laundered money through his legitimate businesses.
Oh, of course. It only makes sense. But, so anyway,
like,
so
she could get fired. I'm sure she violated her employment contract.
but why
I don't think she's being, like, her being arrested makes any sense at all.
Not really, no. But,
You sent the Karen Page stuff and the it was a mistake to kill off Ben Urich because they have to literally just turn this guy suddenly
into Ben Urich.
Ben Urich.
Yeah, yeah, which seems kind of dumb. And, the other thing I was saying is that, so she killed Wesley.
Yeah.
And then they acted in that previous season. Like, this is, like, some big thing that she'd, like, have to hide and feel bad about it. And it's like,
why?
So a criminal takes her into a room where he's threatening her and he puts, like, a gun on the table.
And he's legit going to murder her whole family.
Yeah, and he's legit going to murder her whole family. And then she heroically gets the gun and kills that criminal. And for some reason, she thinks she has to hide this and feel morally ashamed about it. That makes sense. And that's why you can tell that the whole hook with her associating with the Punisher in this season is supposed to be that she's like
through her trauma over that.
Exactly. She's trying to think
over being a hero.
Yeah. If he can be redeemed, quote, then so can I for my similar crime. Right. And it's
you have to be redeemed for being a superhero who killed a murderer. Who was going to kill everyone you love?
Yeah, and it just seems crazy. And so I hope you're right. I don't want that
kind of moralizing to show up in a Punisher story.
Yeah, it should just be about the Punisher, the heroic murderer, as we often say, jokingly. But
yeah, we jokingly say heroic murderer.
Yeah, but the guy who, you know, is a hero who shoots people. That's
He's
his
a
thing,
hero.
Right?
He shoots people.
Cowboys are heroes who shoot people. Nobody seems
to have used to be. And starting in the 50s, they shot guns out of people's hands.
Yeah, and after becoming the softened cowboys, who are like the equivalent of comics code cowboys who shoot guns out of people's hands, then we were treated to, like, again, similar to, like, the Punisher thing. It's like, oh, well, the only guy who would shoot someone is a hard psycho. And I'm not saying it can't be hard, or even kind of, you know... You know, when I use the term psycho here, I'm using in the positive and loose sense of psycho. No, like, you know, like how Riggs was nutty because he jumped off the roof, you know, that kind of psycho.
Totally.
With a guy or whatever, you know, that kind of thing. But I mean, and I know Riggs was also disturbed. And it's okay for them to be disturbed, sort of. I'm okay with them being disturbed by a past trauma, that kind of thing.
Yeah.
But where it's actually, like, moralizing and saying that they're somehow maybe evil because they're, you know, shooting bad guys, I just don't get that, right?
No, I don't think there's something inherently evil about being the Punisher.
No.
Part of that is because, I grew up with Punisher comics. I love the Punisher. I think he's a wonderful character.
Yeah.
But I also don't disagree with his morality, which is that, in this world of rampant unanswered crime where people don't stay in jail, it's fine to murder some guys.
And it's not like he was going around shooting jaywalkers or something. No, he was not shooting crazy, unrealistic murderers, like mass murdering lunatics, you know, and that kind of thing, you know.
And I mean, if I'm being honest, is the Punisher a creepy right-wing fantasy? Okay.
Perhaps.
Yes, he is.
Maybe.
Perhaps. But at the same time, you know, wouldn't you have been happier had someone shot Oliver North?
Yeah, yes.
You know, like, creepy... Yeah. He did that once. He killed
the Punisher. Did that's right. Yeah,
it was awesome.
He gets the job done. He unlike Batman can close the deal, as you say.
He closes the deal.
Yeah, you know who never
Well, do you know what I said in a conference? I don't remember where I said it. Might have been on one of the 100 other shows I do.
Yeah,
that it's like, do you know what I love about the Punisher? He doesn't have any recurring villains.
Exactly right. Yes, exactly right.
Because
yeah.
he gets the job done the first yeah. time.
Yeah.
And maybe that's horrible.
And look at, like, who you know, passed for Punisher recurring villains. I'm assuming he eventually died, but you had Jigsaw, right?
Yep.
And it's like, why is Jigsaw a man with a Jigsaw face? Well, because the first time that they met, Punisher pitched him out a window, yep. a pane glass window, and it just so happened he didn't die. It's yeah. like, it wasn't, like, for lack of trying or something, right?
No, he tried to kill yeah. him, it just didn't work out.
Yeah, like, yeah, that's... and then I think later he may have succeeded in getting rid of Jigsaw, so...
He might have, I'm not sure.
I have no idea. At the very least, it's not for want of trying, so... Yeah, I'm hoping that it's going to be as
a wonderful and brutal. So now I'll ask you the big question. I've already dramatically revealed the storyline that I guarantee that Hollywood doesn't have the guts to do. Which, yep. by the way, that has got to be a ridiculous clickbaity
yes.
title for the video.
I think
so. The one Punisher storyline Hollywood doesn't have the guts to do.
Hey, if we time it for the release of the series, I'm sure it'll be, you know...
I don't think I'm going to wait 2 years to do this video.
Oh, God, is it that long? Oh, my God.
Yeah, like, they just announced it, and it's...
You know, oh, yeah, I guess they only kind of do one.
They've got to get through... They only do one series at a time.
Yeah.
They've shot Luke Cage.
Yeah.
They're going to shoot Iron Fist next, so... Yeah. No, it's going to be a while before there's a Punisher TV show.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Okay.
So I think we should try and do this as fast as possible,
yes.
given to try and coincide with the, you know, the news that there's going to be a Punisher TV show.
Yeah.
So I'll buy a digital copy of the issues in question rather
yeah.
than, you know, tearing the staples out of my copy and scanning it.
Exactly.
Someone has already done that on the internet, so
yeah.
I'll buy it from them.
Exactly.
But anyway, so now since I've already said the one storyline that the Punisher, the one Punisher storyline that Hollywood doesn't have the guts to make,
right?
I will put to you: are there any Punisher storylines you'd like to see them tackle?
Now let's see. There's a couple that they did with like kind of like military corruption. Like there was one where like someone was selling missiles and then, you know, but you can't really do that because the previous, you know, the Daredevil season was, based sort of around
yeah,
that kind
of thing.
Yeah,
the Frank Lucas drug dealing.
I remember there was one where Punisher returned, well, I say returns, but it's like, it turns out, you know, Frank Castle, was it Castiglione? Is that what his,
yep.
his actual family last name is?
Castiglione.
And he goes back to I believe, Sicily, mm-hmm. and it turns out there's like, you know, some members of his family have mafia connections and he gets embroiled in like a mafia Sicilian adventure or something. I remember that
yeah,
being kind
and,
of good.
And the Saracen shows up and kills his family members and he's got a...
That's right. Yeah.
Yeah.
yeah and it's like, that could be something good. I don't know if that's what I would dive into first. And like I said, I just said a minute ago, like, I'd like it to have kind of like an episodic kind of feel. So you would just be doing different kind of, you know, one shot stories from like kind of the classic period.
Right.
In which case, what are some good ones? Punisher takes on a savings and loan might be not quite.
Story.
Yeah.
And, you know, banking evil bankers, they're still relevant today.
Absolutely. A banking corruption episode, you know, could be good. I don't know if that would be like a good overarching plot. What would be a good overarching Punisher plot? That's a good question. If you can't have it be about him resolving the death of his family or something like that.
You can't.
I liked the Jonestown one. That
yeah,
might
the Jonestown
be a little
one
bit,
was really interesting.
Yeah, like that might delve too much into. But then again, Daredevil allowed itself to delve into
supernatural
kind of paranormal
stuff
which, yeah. which eventually happens in the Jonestown one.
Well, Mephisto that, like, shows up. So
yeah, Mephisto shows up. That's right. So
they may not want to have Mephisto show up, but
yeah, yeah, exactly. They might have to have him on the back burner if they want him to appear in Infinity Gauntlet or something. I don't know. But
well, someone recently pitched, I can't wait for this, hopefully they will wrap up all of the contract problems keeping them from having the Fantastic Four
yeah.
right in time for once they get rid of Thanos, you can bring in Doctor Doom.
Yes.
Like, yeah, that would be good.
I would love it if they could bring in Doctor Doom, yeah. Or Galactus.
Galactus is really hard to do.
Galactus is very hard to do.
Really hard to do well. Galactus.
I feel you need a Fantastic Four series, like maybe a Netflix series even, right? To
yeah.
do Fantastic Four right, and it's like Galactus shouldn't appear until like the third season or something.
I get that.
One second, hang on a moment.
Oh, of course.
Yeah. I'll just be back in one sec.
Just mute yourself and I will continue narrating the game.
Excellent.
I don't think he muted himself. Let's see if we can hear people moving around in the background. Yep, that's glasses. Hopefully we hear some talking at some point. So anyway, Nioh. Yeah, I'm not good at it. I mean, I think part of it is Dark Souls 3 is in my head right now. I've been playing nothing but Dark Souls 3 outside of hidden object games. So I'm really locked into how the flow and controls of that game. And this game is similar enough. Like, you see that it is a Dark Souls, you know, wannabe. And as a consequence, I am using Dark Souls rules to play in this world. And it is a world of much faster enemies who are constantly, like, looping around me, which, yeah, that's getting me into a lot of trouble. That being said, I mean, it's likably violent. I'm cutting the heads off of people left, right, and center, and I mean, I'm never going to complain about that in the game. Oh no, I got to cut somebody's head off. How terrible. Doesn't that just sound ridiculous? So I'm enjoying that. It's nice that I've got a super effective bow, like a bow that just chops people's heads off with one swat, with one, I was about to say quill, but of course that's wrong. With one just arrow, I guess. Is there another word for that? Oh, did I finally find a new chest plate? Let's check. I think he's back. Let's find out what's going on there. He is back.
I was doing a bit.
Just, you know, my problems with the game, and oh, I wonder if he's coming back, and blah, 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 blah.
Ah, well, I did.
I'm a funny oaf, is the point I was trying to get at. So anyway, I guess what I'm saying with Punisher is I'm very excited, but my fear is they're going to focus on, what do you call it, Garth Ennis Punisher?
Oh, probably. They might do that story with the Mafia Queen or whatever.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Like that kind of stuff with a lady who's in charge. Like, because they seem to have this fetish not for being episodic, but for doing
full overarching
stories.
And yeah, like, I mean, really,
a lot
it's
of
like
what the really slow-paced, slowly-paced, sorry, Garth Ennis Punisher was known for, is like doing
really
long stories.
Yeah, and Netflix in general has been using that kind of format, right? Like, that which really worked in the first season of Daredevil, but that's because the first season of Daredevil was allowed to have him going and, you know, beating up various gangs and, you know, doing a variety of things, kind of, right?
Oh, yeah.
Whereas Jessica Jones is very, you know, it's like you've got this one plot about the Purple Man.
And it's not that complicated a story.
No,
and
exactly.
It should not have taken that long.
Exactly. It didn't feel justified to take that long. Had they thrown in, like, a couple other things into the mix, I don't know if there's any other, like, Jessica Jones stories. You know, I'm not familiar enough with the character. Like, if there were other things or...
There's a couple of good Jessica Jones stories. I don't like the character in the comic generally, but there's a couple of good stories they could have done. The Purple Man is her definitive origin story, but it's also a garbage story.
Right, right.
Because it's not a convoluted situation at all. Just kill him.
Yes, yeah. It would have been so easy, and there was so many ways around it. I mean, we don't have to get into that here, but it's like...
No, no, we've talked about that before. I'm not gonna relitigate Jessica Jones now.
No.
I'm not a crazy person.
Yeah.
I am obviously a crazy person.
Oh, here's a little fact that people, speaking very loosely, of, oddly enough, Jessica Jones and purple things, weirdly. But anyway.
Okay, that took a twist.
Kristen Ritter, who incidentally...
Ritter, who's great.
I only found out, like, a couple days ago, is not related to John Ritter at all, which for some reason I thought she was his daughter. But
I never thought that for a second. I know Jason Ritter is his son, but I never thought she was in any way related.
I think someone told me that, like, in advance when I started watching Breaking Bad. They were like, Scott, his, you know, John Ritter's daughter is in it or something, right? And I was like,
they
oh.
Were confused by the that? Name.
Yeah, and so I might have been, like, following along with someone else's confusion. But anyway.
Oh, okay.
Nonetheless, she's great. Love her. Can't complain.
Yeah.
But anyway, so she was in, as everyone remembers, Breaking Bad.
Yep.
Where she plays Jesse's girlfriend who
dies tragically of a heroin overdose.
That's right. Yeah, she dies of the heroin overdose, right? And anyway, but before that happens, there's like this mural that she's painted, right?
Yeah.
And in the mural, I'd never noticed this, it's got like a woman kind of wrapped in clouds. And in the background is a purple teddy bear falling from the sky.
Really?
Which is what happens, of course, you know, the whole beginning of that season.
Yeah.
There's the bear's eye lying in the pool. We don't know what it is.
Yeah.
And eventually it turns out that the plane blew up.
It all fits together.
Yeah, and so, like, were they saying she was psychic? Obviously, that's what they're saying, is that she apparently was psychic, at least in the last moments of her death, you know, inadvertently or whatever, and she happened to paint a mural that had the falling purple bear. So there you go. That's a little you know.
That is a weird coincidence, considering the role she would later play.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. So there's this weird kind of thing. I thought that was kind of a
That is interesting.
Thing that I hadn't noticed before. So.
Yeah. No, that's pretty cool.
Yeah. Oh, and here's another thing. Speaking of stuff that appeared in the background of things, I was watching the show Kimmy Schmidt.
Oh, such a fun show.
The new season, and have you watched any of the new season?
I have seen the new season, yes.
Okay, so I haven't seen the whole new season yet, but Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, such a great song. Whoever wrote that song.
And then the Chuck Lorre shows up.
So I didn't know that Chuck Lorre wrote the Ninja Turtles theme.
Yeah, I had recently found that out. Because it was on an episode of 2.5 Men.
Yeah.
They credited Charlie Sheen's character, a jingle writer, with having written that song. And when I saw that episode, I was like, oh, how nice that the whoever wrote that song was able to...
work in Chuck
Lorre. That Chuck Lorre, asked him and, he let them give it to the credit so he would have a famous thing.
Yeah.
But then I read an interview with Chuck Lorre where he, talked about all of his 1,000 jobs.
Right.
And he's like, well, one story was they had gone to popular 60s band The Turtles.
Yeah.
And asked them to write a theme song for that show because everyone who works in Hollywood is stupid.
Yeah. Of course, yeah.
Again, that's obviously why you would go to The Turtles with that job.
Yeah, for sure.
And The Turtles, took months and came up with nothing.
Right.
And so they said, hey, and so he found out this job was available. I guess his manager did. And they were like, do you just want to take a shot at this? And he's like, yeah, I play the piano. What the hell?
Yeah.
And he wrote that in one day.
That's amazing.
And he has made a lot of money after writing that song in one day.
That's amazing.
Yeah, so that is the wonderful story of the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles theme song.
And it's not off topic, because bringing it up involved both the Netflix series and the Turtles that were a ripoff of Frank Miller's Daredevil. So there you go.
That's true, yeah. Famously a ripoff of Frank. Which, by the way, in the little documentary about the Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles that was on Netflix for a while, it takes them like 20 minutes before they mention Daredevil.
Weird. You think that would be like right at the beginning?
That would be like the first thing you say. So there was this comic book that was called Frank Miller's Daredevil. It was unbelievably pretentious, and we wanted to make fun of it. And we liked drawing turtles, so that's what we did.
Yeah, that's how that happened.
Like that is what happened. Daredevil was unbearably pretentious.
Mm-hmm.
And so self-serious. And they thought, how can we make fun of this by having giant mutant turtles have it, which is pretty awesome.
And it's so strange because it's a thing that like it's you have these weird kind of generational divides where it's like you're just of the right age to not know something, right? Like older kids would have known that, right? Like kids who are like just a couple years older than us. But well, at least for my own part anyway, I can say that I hadn't read Frank Miller's Daredevil when I was like 10. When I first saw the Turtles. I guess I was thinking I was like 10 years old, and the cartoon came out, right? And anyway, so there you go.
It's very interesting, isn't it?
And then you find out years later, you're like, oh, it's the foot is the hand.
The foot is the hand. It's a pun. Well, not a pun. It's just a
clever
just a joke.
Play on words or something.
They have the HOGuru, they have the word joke. it's just a joke.
It was a joke. That's what it was.
You don't have to try to look clever and come up with what specific genre of joke it was. You can just say it was a joke.
Yeah.
Because it was.
Yeah.
The hand and the foot. and then you have a 100% serious Michael Bay movie trying to explain that they call themselves the foot because they always step on people.
Is that what it tells you?
That's what was mentioned in that terrible movie.
Wow.
I judged that movie harshly, and I was right to judge that movie harshly.
Yeah, I think even the Kimmy Schmidt episode had the line, Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, when she lists the things she remembers from her childhood, and one of them is the Ninja Turtles, and then the other things, whatever it was, like Pog or something, I don't know, don't really exist anymore. And she's like, Ninja Turtles, that's still a thing?
Yeah. And they're like, Ninja Turtles, those are popular. How is that still a thing?
Yeah, how is that still a thing? Yeah. Which I can totally accept that Ninja Turtles is still a thing. I just can't accept that the Michael Bay Turtles is what is propping that up.
Yeah, it's pretty bad. But, I was sad in season two that I thought her.
Don't spoil.
I'm not. No, it's don't. I'm not going to ruin things for you. I'm not a monster.
Right.
No, here's the one thing that made me mildly sad.
Yeah.
Is I thought her interplay with Jane Krakowski's stepdaughter.
Yeah.
Was very funny in the first season.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like, I thought they had actually a very good comic relationship.
Yeah, yeah, it worked.
And so I was sad to see her only in one episode of season two.
Oh,
spoiler alert, she doesn't come back.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah, because I
saw the episode she was in, she doesn't come back. And that's the one thing that really, you know, I thought they weren't using people to their full comedic extent.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Because the two of them were so funny together the first season.
Yeah. Well, that's a shame.
Yeah, it is a shame. But then again, she was no longer working for her full time, so I understand.
Exactly. It makes some sense. Maybe she'll be back in the third season. If there's
who can say? I'm sure there definitely will be a third season. I was about to say, it made plenty of money, but of course that's not how Netflix works.
No, I guess not.
Netflix works by giving you the sense that they have enough content to justify you paying $120 a year.
Yeah.
So it doesn't matter if a certain show makes a certain amount of money, it just matters that people have the impression that having access to that show is worth their continued subscription.
Do you think it'll ever be invaded by advertising? Do you think they'll ever become like some kind of...
Well, first off, they are already doing product placement.
Yeah, product placement.
So, in a sense, there is already advertising on their original shows.
Mm-hmm.
But do I ever think there's going to be an ad between watching episodes of Brooklyn Nine-Nine on... I mean, I hope not. I can't say for sure that there won't be, because, you know, corporations are corporations, and corporations are all monsters who deserve nothing but our scorn.
Yes.
But, you know, I hope. I can certainly hope.
Yeah.
I understand it springs eternal.
Sure. It's true.
Thank you for accepting a cliche as received wisdom. Sure. Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
I accept that.
That's a thing I've heard too.
Yeah.
I'll go along with that without questioning it, really.
But yeah.
No, I appreciate that.
I'm hoping anyway that the upcoming season will be good. And
I hope, like, so coming back to The Punisher.
Mm.
There are so many good things you can do with The Punisher that I don't want them to feel limited to just Garth Ennis Punisher.
Punisher,
because, like, I understand the instinct to focus on the modern, like, either Garth Ennis or the post-Garth Ennis people who have modernized The Punisher to say he was, like, in Afghanistan or something.
Right.
Like, I understand why.
Actually, you know, when Ennis did it, he was still in Nom.
That's why I said the post-Garth Ennis.
Oh, post-Garth Ennis, yeah.
Well, no, but when Ennis did it, he was staying with the continuity where he died and came back from heaven.
That's right, so they could explain why he was...
He was, like, 60, you know?
Yeah.
And then Jason Aaron came on and tried to do the same thing and brought back the Kingpin in Punisher Max, which was set apart from the regular Marvel Universe, and it just... It wasn't great. It was okay, but it wasn't great.
Right.
And just modern people, again, they think there's something wrong with being the Punisher.
Yeah.
And the Punisher cannot withstand moralizing.
That is
when you're going to fail to do a satisfying Punisher story.
Yeah.
If you're adding moralizing to it. And that's what I most want them to understand. But, like, at least the Punisher character...
Mm-hmm.
And theoretically, the point of view of the show itself should be that there is nothing wrong with being the Punisher.
Exactly, yeah, and that's what we're hoping for, I guess, with the Punisher. Is just
that is what I'm hoping most for.
Yeah,
you know, like I want the Punisher to just be a guy who's out there murdering the H out of criminals.
Oh, and he should also have a big skull on his chest.
And he should be working with Microchip.
Yeah, which they did set up. Here's something I definitely don't want. I don't want Microchip a la James Bond's Q to be like a hip young teen hipster.
No. No, he's got to be a middle-aged computer nerd.
Yeah, he's got to be, yeah.
He can be older than the Punisher. That's fine.
That's totally fine, yeah.
Oh my god, an Oni!
Ooh, nice.
Yeah, when you see the Oni, you'll be like, What? An oni? What are you talking about? What does that word mean?
And I know what that
you
is.
You will remember what that word means. You'll be like,
the horned person.
When you see him, you'll be so panicky that I feel like that's how you'll react.
Yeah. Let's see. You're right. I correctly, you, that was a correct assessment.
Thank you.
Looks a little like a horned hellboy here.
Yeah, kind of.
Yeah.
He's got, you know, the definition of an oni mask.
Yeah.
Like, that's a real face version of an oni mask. And, oh, he kicked my ass. Yeah, if I knew how to defend myself.
Yeah.
But the game still has never taught me how to block or counter.
You've got you've ate one of them things, obviously.
You'll see me die very shortly.
You know what the Punisher, the ethos they should be following? This is what I thought when watching a recent Liam Neeson movie, Nonstop.
Yeah.
What I thought, even though I had some issues with Nonstop, Liam Neeson films, at least for the last several years, and when I say Liam Neeson films, I don't mean like Kinsey or something. I'm not talking about when I say Liam Neeson,
we all know about the Taken-verse. It's okay.
Taken and similar Liam Neeson films.
Yeah.
Such as this one was. They don't apologize for being what they are. And that's what the Punisher shouldn't do. There should be no apologizing or excusing that it's like, here's a film, it's about a guy. He's some kind of CIA hard man, and they've kidnapped his daughter. Boy, did they make a mistake. And that's all the film is, right? And it's not like going, oh, well, gee, golly, let's be sarcastic about that or overly moral about it or question that in
let's
some way.
Worry about what the kids may think of him rescuing his daughter from Middle Eastern rapists.
Yeah, exactly. There's no apologizing about that. And that's what I like, about it. Not that I'm saying it's like, oh, well, in real life we can't question something like that or whatever. I'm just saying that it's just a stupid story. Enjoy it for what it is. And we'll all have a good time, right?
Yeah.
And I think that a lot of people got that with the Taken films, right? And so it's like, that's what I'm hoping for with the Punisher or whatever, right? Like,
apparently I have 25 skill points that I haven't bothered spending. I'm an embarrassing person.
Yeah.
So please continue.
Yeah, and so that's what I'm hoping is what they follow. Don't bother to apologize for this show being about the Punisher.
Okay.
Yeah. Yeah.
No, and I don't think they should. It really
is. Yeah, that's what everything, like any time Hollywood buys a property, like if you have bought a property,
yeah,
and you intend to make a movie about it, don't apologize for what it was. Like, obviously, but the thing is, the problem is the way that these things are bought doesn't
work. I had to buy the ability to counter.
Oh, okay, that's why you couldn't. Okay, now it makes sense.
Yeah, if I guard right before a dude hits me, that's how you do the counter. So yeah, all this time I've been trying to do the counter, and I hadn't bought the skill yet. And I was sitting here with 25 skill points I could have been spending.
That is what you said originally, that you didn't like loot-based
games.
Come back to bite you in the ass.
It really has, hasn't it?
Had you been a big fan of them, you would have been like, oh, that's obviously how I get it.
Yeah, that's bad.
Oh, well.
All right, I'm an embarrassing oaf. Sorry for complaining so much, game. I really should have. Oof. That was bad. So, anyway, yes. I'm looking forward to. Wait a minute! I can summer a fire puppy.
Nice.
Remember the fire puppy?
I do.
I could have summoned him while I was fighting the oni.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm not smart.
And you got to check all this inventory stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, I really do. Ooh, that's bad. Ooh, parrying an enemy attack.
See, there you go. Get that.
Awesome. Yeah, wow. Okay. Oh,
in a way, discovering this now is kind of good because it's sort of cyclical to the very beginning of this.
It really is, isn't it? Yeah. I'm now, all of that complaining nonsense I did, I now have, I've learned a valuable lesson.
The hero has returned, but with a boon. You have completed the Joseph Campbell cycle of crap.
It's so true.
Excellent.
Oh my god. All right, so let's pull out the katana and see how this stuff works.
Okay.
Ooh. Oh, wow. Mid-stand skill. Parries an enemy attack, then places you behind them. That sounds amazing.
Why did
I not learn any of this? Oh, well, we know why. I'm an idiot.
Don't be so harsh.
No, you're right. Thank you for supporting me. But yeah, I'm cautiously optimistic. You know, I think it's going to be good. I think it's. I hope the Punisher series is good.
Yeah.
I have every expectation that it's going to be, and, you know, fingers crossed, they will not disappoint. Again, I really liked the casting of the Punisher.
Oh, yeah, great. He was excellent for the part. I was worried that he was going to be, like, someone who just doesn't fit in some way or whatever. But no, they did a good job.
Yeah. And, you know what? He was fine on The Walking Dead. Yeah. The Walking Dead wasn't fine. The Walking Dead has never been fine. The Walking Dead is a sack of garbage.
But as you said, you have sat down again to watch it specifically because you like the performance of two of the actors who are going to be coming up on the show. So it's not the actor's fault that The Walking Dead.
No, I don't blame. I would never blame him for the garbage that is for the dumpster fire that is The Walking Dead. I'm not going to blame. Oh, I can actually say his name. John Bernthal.
There you go, John Bernthal.
I knew his name.
Yeah.
Much like the Kurgan.
I know his name. Yes.
A little Highlander reference to wrap things up, getting us back to Highlander, which we weren't actually talking about on the show. So
no, that was before.
Might be very confusing for an audience.
As always.
Oh my god!
Third time.
You're going to see me actually pull off one of those techniques I was talking about, and it's going to blow your mind how awesome it looks.
Yeah.
So let's go deal with that Oni by asking my fire puppy to give me the power to kill him.
Okay, that sounds good.
Fire puppy!
At least you didn't
say... I'm an oaf. And on the video version, it's going to make more sense because I said fire puppy as I was pressing it.
Yeah, you were unleashing the fire puppy.
And then for some reason I don't understand, my fire puppy lasted 8 seconds. No, not even 8 seconds, like 3 seconds.
I now remember, see you summoning me.
Remember when I did that hammer attack and it lasted forever and I did a great job?
Yep.
No, that is the opposite of what happens this time.
No. Okay, I'm so bad at this. 1 second. It's so strange being in this delayed reactiverse.
I know. Now, we got to get you over here to,
to
do this stuff in person more often.
Yeah, I think I'll be in town for, what's that called? Victoria Day, the kids call it. For those non-Canadians, we have this thing where we celebrate, I think...
Queen Victoria, inventor of Ottawa.
Good job. I was trying to think of a famous Victoria who isn't Queen Victoria.
Victoria Tennant.
I suck, so I couldn't think one. Yeah, there you go.
Wait, who's the one from Saturday Night Live?
Oh, Victoria Jackson?
Victoria Jackson.
Victoria Jackson.
Crazy right-wing conspiracy theorist, Victoria Jackson.
Okay.
By the way, I wish that wasn't an accurate description of her.
I know nothing about her.
She is now definitively a crazy right-wing conspiracy theorist.
That's
what she does with her time. She goes around Fox News singing comedy songs about how global warming is a lie made up by the Jews. Again, it sounds like I'm kidding. I'm not.
I'll find out.
It's sad. All right, so on that note, the note of me discussing Victoria Jackson's...
Yeah.
My claim about Victoria Jackson's anti-Semitism...
Yes.
Let's move on and wrap up the show and just say that I want to thank you for making it all the way through with us. I think we had a lot of good conversations about your John Bernthal Punisher, and the various places that show could go, and the fact that we're really optimistic about it. Like, I know people say, "Oh, HOGuru." Well, they don't say it about HOGuru because HOGuru is actually a really positive person. But oh, one of my various other personas, you always hate the media. You only talk about stuff you hate and stuff you don't like. And oh, well, did you ever like anything? Didn't anything ever suit you? HOGuru.
Is the answer Highlander?
It is Highlander. I love Highlander.
Oh, yeah.
I cannot stop talking about how great Highlander is. But no, seriously. I thought as a Punisher super fan, I thought it was a good performance, and I'm looking forward to him doing the show justice going forward. So, any final words from you?
Because you called yourself a Punisher super fan, my final word will be da Punisher. Sad way to sign off, but
Punishers. So anyway, speaking of, I wasn't speaking of that, but bear with me for 1 second. I'd like to make my point. I appreciate you accepting what's about to be a crazy thing I'm going to say. What I'm really looking forward to, right, is a little thing called. Sorry about that. The thank you video I'm putting up. That's right. In between last week, where we just out of the blue, crafted the idea of putting up a thank you video for our subscribers upon reaching 20 subscribers. That actually happened this week. So I was not expecting it to happen that fast. So I have actually produced the video. I'm going to be editing it. And, you know, and now I realize I'm telling this elaborate story. I might actually get the video posted before I post this. So if you haven't checked it out yet, if you're one of our subscribers, by all means, check out the thank you video. It's our way of saying, hey, we appreciate you subscribing. And if you're not a subscriber, subscribe first and then watch it, or else you're kind of cheating. Like, it's not for you. It's for people who have supported the channel. And now I'm being a jerk about that. All right, so that took a turn from really humble and thankful to just me being a jerk for no reason. So I should really, you know, get my life right, man. Seriously, though. Thank you so much, and I will see you here next time.
Right on.